Hello everyone, my name is Wes Bunn and I'm a senior technical writer here with Epic Games, and today we're going to be talking about skeleton assets inside Unreal Engine 4 to help clear up some of the common misconceptions about them, as well as show exactly what they can do and why they are a super important part of importing and animating characters inside Unreal Engine. Now, if you are already familiar with animating characters in any of the popular animation tools like 3ds Max or Maya or Blender, for example, you probably have a solid understanding of what is involved in animating a character. But from a super high level perspective, we'll cover that process here together really quickly, just so that we're all on the same page. So usually first you create the outer appearance of your character in the form of a skeletal mesh. And this is usually the 3D model that you visually see. With that done, then there's the skeleton setup or rigging of the character. And rigging the character includes adding and defining the bone or joint hierarchy, which you can then manipulate into poses, and then animate those poses by keyframing those individual poses over a timeline, which you can use to create animations. So if you're familiar with the old stop motion, you know, pose a character and then snap a picture and then move a character again into a new position and repeat that process over and over again, it's a very similar concept when keyframing animations. And you can use that to create pretty much any animation that you want, running, walking, punching, whatever it is you want your character to be doing. Now that's usually how we create animated characters externally. In a moment, we'll talk about how Unreal takes and applies those animations to your characters inside Unreal Engine. So once you finish setting up your character externally, and I keep saying character, but really it could be anything actually. You could create a kite, for example, and use that as your skeletal mesh and add bones or joints to make up the spine and additional bones to animate the tail of the kite, for example. But once you have that asset ready, then you can import it into Unreal Engine 4. And this is probably where the biggest misconception occurs in terms of skeleton assets inside Unreal. That being the notion that each skeletal mesh that you import must have a direct one-to-one connection with its own unique skeleton asset inside Unreal. And this is not necessarily the case. So to clear the air on this, let's actually take a step back for a second. So in most 3D applications, as we mentioned a moment ago, a skeleton is a digital hierarchical framework used to define the bones in a character, and in many ways mimics a real biological skeleton. In Unreal Engine 4, the skeleton asset is less like a 3D representation of an actual skeleton, and is more like, well really it's more like a list is all it is. And that list contains the bone and hierarchy information for a skeletal mesh. That list is then in turn used to drive animation for the skeletal mesh that it is associated with, among other things that we'll get into a little bit later. So Unreal Engine looks at the skeleton asset or list of information and says, okay, where are all the bones and what's the hierarchy between those bones? With that information, I can use that to play animations for the character or even multiple characters. That's the important thing, is that the skeleton asset, and I keep trying to drive it home here, but that list of information can be used for multiple skeletal meshes. You do not need to have a unique skeleton asset for each skeletal mesh that you import. Now there are some stipulations that we'll touch upon in a moment, but really, Unreal only cares about the bone and hierarchy information for the skeletal mesh that it is assigned to. So say we created a skeletal mesh inside of our favorite modeling program, and then we go through the rigging process and hook up our skeletal mesh to a skeleton, and perhaps we even create a walking animation for him that we want to import as well. That's my sad skeleton, by the way. Yours will most certainly look better than mine. But anyway, we are set and we choose to import this skeletal mesh into Unreal along with our walk animation. Now, along with the various import options, we can assign a skeleton asset for our character to use. If we do not assign one, don't worry. One is automatically created for us whenever we choose to import skeletal meshes and we choose not to assign one. Now, remember that that skeleton asset is just a list of sorts that will keep track of the bone location and hierarchy information of the skeleton that was used when we rigged our skeletal mesh. It's just passing that information over to the skeleton asset inside of Unreal. So with all of that, we choose to import. Our character has been imported. He's skinned and he's rigged and he has a walk animation, and that makes us super happy because we have a character inside of the engine. But we are not content with that. We want another character. So we go back to our favorite modeling program and we create another character that looked a little bit different this time. And maybe for this second character, we also created a run animation this time around that we want to import as well. But when we rigged this character, We rigged them in the same way as our first character. All of our bones are in the same location in terms of hierarchy, and our bone names are the same. So all of that information already exists in the skeleton asset we created when we imported our first character. Since both characters are set up the same way and only the skeletal mesh has changed, we do not need to create another skeleton asset at this point when we import our second character. When we import the second character, all we need to do is select the skeleton asset as part of the import process. And that skeleton asset was created again when we imported our first character. So it has all that information about our setup. And we can do this because the bone and the hierarchy setup for our two characters are the same. So our second character has been imported. He is also skin rigged, and we imported a run animation for him to use. Now the super cool thing is that since both characters are sharing the same skeleton asset, both characters can now use the walk and run animations that we imported. And they can do so without any problems because they are sharing the same skeleton asset. This is because Unreal knows the bone and hierarchy information of both characters, which it will use to drive the animation when it is applied to each skeletal mesh. You can even take it a step further and say create a smaller character or a child in your favorite modeling program, and as long as you rig it the same as the other two characters that we mentioned a moment ago, as long as you do not disrupt the bone naming convention or the hierarchy setup, when we import this third character can use the same skeleton asset that the other two characters are using. Now all three characters could share animations between each other because their information is the same. This is really useful since we do not need to create a separate set of animations for each of our characters. They can share the base animations, and then we can concentrate on unique or cool one-off animations that we want to provide for each individual character if we'd like. Now, although each character can share animations between each other, there might be some adjustments that we will want to make to make sure that our animations aren't stretched or compacted based on which skeletal mesh that the skeleton asset is referring to when it's playing animations. And we're going to touch upon this more in a moment when we jump into the editor. But that process, which we call retargeting, will help alleviate some of those issues. It's another thing that the skeleton asset will do for us. Not only does the skeleton asset keep track of bone information for location and rotation, but when using retargeting, it also contains and uses bone transform information. Again, if you're completely new to using skeletons in Unreal, you may be saying, huh, what was that? Don't worry, we'll put this to good use here in a moment when we jump inside the editor. Well, that's all fine and good if we have characters that we rig the same, but what if we had a character with four arms or a tail or something like that? Would we need to use a different skeleton asset in this case? Well, depending upon your setup, that may not be the case. So if we take our skeleton example that we've been using here, as long as our base bone setup and hierarchy is the same and our naming convention is the same and we are just adding things to it like extra arms or a tail, so something like this, for example, this is perfectly fine. In this instance, we do not need to use a separate skeleton asset when we choose to import this character into Unreal because the base bone information and hierarchy are the same. When we do so, this character would also be able to share animations with the previous three characters that we showed a moment ago. Now, this character may need some supplemental animation to animate the tail or extra arms, but at least you'd have something to start with, and you could share those base animations. Any characters that don't have a tail or extra arms would just not use that data. Only the character that have those additions would use that data, and this is perfectly fine. Where things become a problem, however, when we create a character but change the bone hierarchy significantly or rename any of the bones in the hierarchy and then choose to import that character, it is in those cases where we would need to use a separate skeleton asset. For example, here's a setup of our character's arm, for example. And we just said that we can add things to the hierarchy like so, so this is perfectly fine. But as soon as we change up the hierarchy like so, that is a problem because Unreal will look at the bone and hierarchy information and see that the order has changed. Even though they are using the same amount of bones, the hierarchy and potentially the naming convention might have changed, which would be problematic. The same holds true to our skeleton example. If we added bones, say, here or here in the arms, like so, This would be a problem as well. The hierarchy is now different, and we would not be able to share skeleton assets when we import this skeletal mesh. The same is true for the names of your bones. If you rename your bones or use different bone names, but the hierarchy was the same, you wouldn't be able to share skeleton assets in that instance either, because the list information is not the same. The takeaway is that adding two things is okay. Reordering or renaming, changing is not. That's the important takeaway there. Now, it's not the end of the world. There are other measures that you can take in these instances in order to share animations between characters that use different skeleton assets, but there's a little extra work involved when doing so. It's that retargeting process that we kind of talked about, which we'll show once we hop into the editor here in a moment. So now that we know a little bit about what skeleton assets are in Unreal, we know that they are a list of bone names and hierarchy information, essentially, and that they are used to drive the animation of characters in Unreal. Also, that they can be shared among multiple skeletal meshes as long as that base bone and hierarchy information are the same. But what else do skeleton assets do for us? Well, we also mentioned that skeleton assets are used in retargeting for different meshes. And again, we'll jump into the editor here to kind of showcase this in a moment. But that super tiny character and then that gigantic large character that are sharing the same skeleton asset and share animations, skeleton retargeting may be needed to ensure that the animations aren't disproportionately stretched or compacted when playing those animations on their respective meshes. Now, we could also retarget animations themselves, and this will allow us to share animations between two skeletal meshes that are using different skeleton assets. Now, you might be saying, wait a minute, I thought in order to share animations between two characters, or two skeletal meshes, I should say, that they must use the same skeleton asset. Generally, this is the best case scenario, as there's very little work involved in getting the two skeletal meshes to share animations, unless you're doing some skeleton retargeting like we just mentioned. But in the event that your characters do not share the same skeleton asset and you want them to share animations, you can use retargeted animations. But this involves a little bit more extra work to set up, and this is something that we're going to show inside the editor in a moment as well. But back to skeleton assets themselves, they are also used to create sockets, save notify names, curve names, and slot names. And we're going to show these, setting these up as well inside the editor. But very quickly, say you wanted a character to carry something in their hands. We could create a socket inside the skeleton asset attached to the character's hand. We could then populate that socket with a sword or a gun, for example. And as the character moves around or plays any animation, the sword or gun would just move along for the ride. The cool thing is that any other skeletal meshes that use that same skeleton asset would also be able to populate and use that socket to attach things to. So it just makes things a lot easier. We don't need to do it for each of our characters, essentially. As for notifies, they can be used to fire off particle effects or sounds at a defined point in an animation, for example, footstep sounds as the character is walking around, etc. However, you can also create custom notifies, which will fire off events that can kick off Blueprint script. And this works like a normal event inside of Blueprint, and it can be used to trigger pretty much anything you want. These custom notifies are saved along with the skeleton asset so that you can reuse them with multiple characters that use that skeleton asset without having to create those notifies each time you want to call those events. So it's very important to save your skeleton assets. When you're creating notifies, you'll be working inside of an animation to actually add the notify, but you'll also need to save that skeleton asset. That is where the notify is attached to. Otherwise, you may lose it. So save often, worry less is the motto that I tend to go by. Very quickly, though, before we wrap up this video, I wanted to talk about some of the other things here. So skeleton assets are also used to save curve names. And these can be used to influence morph targets, modify bone transforms, or drive the change of any material parameters that you may have set up. So say you wanted a character to exhibit a blush or some other expression which is driven by a material parameter, you could use a curve to drive that change. Now those curves need a place to be saved as well, not in a particular animation, but with the skeleton asset, so they too can be reused across multiple characters that share the skeleton asset. And then finally, we have slot names, and these are a way that you can set up and perform split body animations. So you could define a slot, which we choose to call upper body, for example, which starts at the hips. We can then use that slot to apply animation to anything above or below it. So we could play a walking motion on our legs while our upper body performs a gun reloading animation, for example. Those slot names, as with curves, notifies, and sockets, need a place to be saved, and they are saved along with the skeleton asset, allowing you to use them across multiple characters that use that skeleton asset again. So you can kind of see the trend here. There's a lot of repurposing and reusing. So this is why you need to save your skeleton asset. So with all of that, I know we've covered a lot here. I'd actually like to pause now, and then we'll pick it back up in the next video where we jump inside of the editor and start to demo some of these things that we've talked about to really drive home the concept of using skeleton assets inside of Unreal. So we're going to pause here and we'll pick it back up in a moment inside the editor.